welcome everybody, also from my part. So I was asked to start again with this roadmap, so you already heard a lot about this. But I will specify what I will be talking about. So I will be talking mainly about the motivating issues, so about researchers' degrees of freedom and the scientific misconduct. So I will talk a lot about what's going wrong right now in science, and not that much about the solutions, because the solutions will be talked about by other people. And I think one of the main messages that is in my talk is that we as scientists are also human. Sean also mentioned this, so it's really looking at the human factors in science and how this influences the results. So who am I? I'm Marian Bakker. I'm from Tilburg University in the Netherlands, and I study psychology, and I'm currently at the methods and statistics department of the social science school in at Tilburg University. So I mainly work with psychologists, but also some other social sciences. And my interest is mainly in meta science. So how do researchers do their research? How do they analyze their data? And so I studied, for example, the misreporting of statistical results. And also power, and currently I'm also looking at pre-registration and how we can implement this and how this is done currently. So that's mainly what I'm doing. So because I'm from psychology, and in psychology we in general use null hypothesis significance testing, so this will be this focus on the p-value that should be lower than 0.05, so that will be mainly what I'm talking about. So that's just a little bit about me and my perspective. So I wanted to talk about the 50 shades of gray in science. And so I really want to talk about this gray, because I think sometimes people expect that we in science, we're all white, so we already talked about those norms and how we should be good scientists, and that we expect to be all in this white corner of truly objective, rational scientists, and that we only have a few rotten apples that are totally wrong. And since I'm not totally wrong, I'm still in the good part, right? So that's, I think, sometimes how people think about this. And this is also a little bit like the storybook image of a scientist. Koshi, a colleague of mine, also investigated this. And she investigated whether people really think about scientists in this way. And she showed that lay people, but also scientists, think that scientists are more objective, rational, open-minded, intelligent, more honest than other highly educated people. So we really think that we are doing quite well on these norms. However, I think when we really look into science, and it's even getting more dark on this screen than it was on my computer at home, so I intended it to be a little bit lighter than this, but I think a lot of us scientists are more in the middle. So we do some crazy stuff, and our intentions are often good, but we have to do a lot of things, we have to make a lot of decisions, and this has some consequences on the credibility of our science. So I wanted to talk about this in between, this gray area. So, just a very short overview. I want to start with the black. So that's more the scientific misconduct, so fraud and these kind of things. And then to the gray, and this is more the researchers' degrees of freedom. So more the wiggle room that we already talked a little bit about, that researchers have. So, starting with the scientific misconduct. And please, if you have questions, just ask. I think we have time enough to answer all the questions, and it's good to have discussions and when it's not clear, then please ask me. So we have several definitions of scientific misconduct, but one that is often used is FFP, or fabrication, falsification, and plagiarism. So we have fabrication, which is really making up the results, data or results. Falsification, which is more about changing or omitting some data. And we have plagiarism, in which you use the work of others without crediting them for their work. And yeah, I think there is some difference between them, because when we look at plagiarism, it's really bad for the people that are whose work has been used. However, it often don't affect the credibility of the results. Well, when you fabricate your data, or you falsify your data, you change your data, then this has a direct effect on what's published in the literature. It's not based on anything anymore. So it has a more direct effect on science itself, on the knowledge that we have. So how often does this occur? Approximately 0.5 to 2%, but this is really difficult to investigate, because of course people are not really open about committing fraud. However, there are some questionnaires in which they ask scientists about this, and they get these kind of numbers, so 0.5 to 2% of the researchers, but we're really not sure whether this is just the top of the iceberg or a good approximation. But of course, this had a lot of consequences. So we have distorted findings in the literature, sometimes also with direct consequences. For example, we have a Dutch guy, Tom Polderman, so I'm also from the Netherlands, and we have quite a few cases of scientific misconduct, so they will come up in the slides as well. I don't know whether that has something to do with being Dutch, but there are some good examples there. And he was investigating different therapies for heart diseases, and some of the medical guidelines for the treatment of certain heart diseases were also based on the trials by him in which misconduct occurred. So this then has a direct influence on the treatment of patients, and so that's really a bad consequence, of course. And in the end, having a lot of misconduct cases also results in less trust in science. So the question is, why are people committing fraud? And and one of the reasons, of course, is this publication pressure, the publish or perish culture. So we have to score, we have to get our results, and also, of course, the scientists are also ambitious people. They want to get hired, they want to get a full professor. So we have those pressures, but of course we also have the opportunity. Often researchers work in quite lonely settings, so you do a lot of work from your own office without anybody looking at what you're doing, so there's also a lot of opportunity. However, other processes are also going on, and therefore I wanted to look to two fraud cases. The first one is Erik T. Poelman, who is a scientist in human obesity and aging, and he was even sentenced to jail because of the fabrication of data in several papers and grants, because also his fraud led to the loss of governmental money, obstruction to justice. So he was one of the people that is really sentenced to jail. And he explained why he thought it was acceptable. And one of the main reasons is that he really believed in his work, and I think that's one of the main issues that will come back also when we talk about those questionable research or the researcher's degrees of freedom, is that you believe in your work, you're doing your studies because you really believe in the theory. Otherwise, you probably would choose something else to study. And he also believed that others were dependent of him. And this is probably also true, because when he don't get funding, then also the other people that work in his lab will also lose their job in the end. And of course, also more the ambition, he wanted to be a respected scientist. So we see already some more human influences, like believing in your own work, believing that you're important for others, ambition. And then I wanted to talk about this guy, who don't know Diederik Stapel. So most of you know, okay, that's good. So Diederik Stapel, I will shortly talk about him, is a Dutch psychologist. He did his PhD in Amsterdam, just like me. And he also went to Tilburg University, and he even became the dean at Tilburg University. And he fabricated his data, and he was detected by whistleblowers, so some of his students, they realized that something was wrong in his data, and they tried to replicate it and talked about this, and in the end they talked to other people at the university, and who confronted Stapel, and in the end he confessed that he fabricated his data. And this led to some committees who checked all his work, and that were now 58 retractions. And so there's a lot of studies. If you want to follow those retractions, not only from Stapel but from all other fields, you can also look at the blog Retraction Watch. So it's interesting, sometimes disturbing, to see what's going on. And he is also known from his studies, for example, that when you're in a messy environment, you are more, how do you say it? You're, more, you're sitting further away from people from other races and things like that. So, so that was one of his main studies that is also retracted. So, but it's interesting because he confessed. So a lot of people who are accused of scientific misconduct don't confess to it, but he did, and he also wrote a book about this. So we know a little bit about how he got to do this. So this is from his book. So yeah. You can make a career out of that as well. So after years of balancing on the outer limits of scientific integrity...
No crime pays, right? I mean, after writing the book, no crime pays.
Okay? Yeah.
So now he's famous with that. Mm-hmm. Wow.
Yes. He's getting famous with that, yeah. But I think, yeah, he tries sometimes to do something in the Netherlands, but then still you... He got a lot of critique, and so it's difficult for him to really build a career, but yeah. So after years of balancing on the outer limits of scientific integrity, the gray became darker and darker until it was black, and I fell off the edge into the abyss. I've been having trouble with my experiments for some time. Even with my various gray methods for improving the data, or fewer questionable research practices, I wasn't able to get the results the way I wanted them. I couldn't resist the temptation to go a step further. I wanted it so badly. I wanted to belong, to be part of the action, to score. So what we see here is that he's going from gray, grayer, to really the black. So also first using these questionable research practices, or the researchers' degrees of freedom that we will be talking about later on in this talk, and then going to real scientific misconduct and just fabricating your own data. Yes?
Are there particular institutional structures that make scientific conduct misconduct more prone?
Are there specific scientific aspects of institutions, aspects of scientific institutions that make scientific misconduct more prone is the question. I think, of course, this pressure to publish and to make a lot of the decisions really dependent on this on your results are some of the reasons that are people using those questionable research practices, but also go into fraud. And maybe something else is more. We work, of course, a lot independent with not much supervision. I think that's great and also one of the benefits of the job, but that might also be one of the risks. I don't know whether there might be more in the Netherlands, but yeah. So there are some aspects, I think, yeah. Yes?
Yeah, thank you. There's this issue about this IMF staff estimate data that we often use in developing countries where we lack data a lot. And when you dig deeper into how those data are obtained, you just call a few people locally, ask them some questions, and they use that to generate the data. So how reliable and are those part of the gray that we are talking about? And how much reliable are these kind of people?
Oh, okay. So your question is that sometimes
like organizations people like that, could we say that they are also engaging in some of the issues you are talking about?
Mm-hmm. So the question is, how bad is it, or?
Yes, are those data, are they reliable, if at all? And can we also categorize them as being involved in some of these fraudulent activities?
Mm-hmm. I think it's just making up data is, of course, is wrong. But there is, of course, a lot in between, and that's what we will be talking about later on, about all the wiggle room or the things that you can do, and then it's not that clear always whether it is wrong or that it is only wrong after when you have seen the data. So then it's a more complex situation, and then it's harder to just say that that's the case. Is that an answer? I don't know.
Yes, let me talk more a bit about that. No, sometimes when you use this IMF staff estimate data, those things are actually different from the one that is being produced by the economy, by the countries themselves.
Mm-hmm.
No, and you tend to, like, what is the meaning of this and which one you actually use? You use that of the IMF because if IMF generates the data, it's different from the one that's generated elsewhere.
Mm.
So you are wondering that which one is reliable, and does it mean that an organization like that is also engaging in some of the issues that you are talking about? So
yeah,
that makes it.
So you're talking about that you have those different ways to collect the data and or get the data, and that they give different results, and then
yes, of course. You are getting different results when you are using different data sources on the same issue. So, the one.
Yeah. I think it's difficult when you have these different data coming from different sources, and then to get to know what the truth is or what is correct. So I will later talk about a little bit about statistical methods to detect fraud. So sometimes you can use statistics to detect fraud or potential fraud, because you often don't know whether that's real fraud or just some honest errors or something else that's going on.
So maybe if I could follow up to what you are saying, I think sometimes it becomes problematic because from some of these definitions,
mm-hmm.
like for example, where I come from, let's take what he has talked about IMF and even World Bank. The way they define a concept like poverty,
mm-hmm.
you find that they say somebody earning less than $1.025 a day.
Yeah.
But you find that in Kenya, somebody who has cows and has land,
mm-hmm.
has food, but doesn't have money,
yes.
cannot consider himself poor.
Yeah.
But now, according to World Bank, you find that he's. So I think that's what it is.
Yes, yeah.
So we, as Kenyans, we see you're very rich. But when it comes to IMF, we are lower, very. We are lower income countries. So I think that's a problem.
Yeah. Yes, just to say some to talk about it also for the people in the back who maybe can hear it. So it might be that the IMF defines poverty at a very different scale, just having money, a very low amount of money. But people in Kenya can have cows and land and everything, but not money. So they can, according to the IMF norms, they are poor. However, it's differently seen in. Yes, it's. I think that's. That's a difficult part of doing research, probably in these fields. It has to do with how you specify your research concepts, like poverty or something else. And I don't think that something is wrong with specifying it in one way or the other way, as long as you are transparent about this and. Yes.
Yes, just wanted to get back to what Aurori said. Actually, there are cases that where you can create data,
mm-hmm.
and this is not fraud, it's more falsification. Because I think that what we are talking about, if you explain the way you constructed your data, I won't call it falsification or fraud.
Yes.
And about the data from IMF or from the World Bank, I mean, sometimes they do estimate. I mean, they estimate like data for some years. They even state it clearly in the database. They said that data from this year to this year are collected in the field, but from that year to the other one, they have been estimated.
Mm-hmm.
And this is clearly stated there.
Yes.
So I won't call this like falsification or fabrication.
Yes.
Because it's all about transparency, what you are saying, and they are transparent when they say. How they are getting those things. And just because they do not have actually the real data that they are seeing this.
Yes.
So one advice would be that if you have the real data, use that one.
Yeah.
Don't use estimate if you have the real data. But sometimes we need maybe to see some patterns you may be, you know, tempted to try to see in a longer term, you know, how data may be, you know, evolving. So sometimes people may use, you know, some relations, some tools to build, you know, and they explain those things.
Yeah. Yes, thank you. I think it's really clear, and I think that's a good question that I now can address. Like, it's not a problem to make up sometimes data in a good way. When you're transparent about that, for example, you also have also for other when you do some other experimental design and you have missing data, then there are also imputation methods that are creating values for those missing data, and those are totally fine methods that you can use, but you should be transparent about that. That you use those methods, that you use those estimates, and when you do that, then that's okay. That's not scientific misconduct. Yes. So this is also a little part from an interview in the New York Times. So also if you commit fraud, you can be interviewed for the New York Times. This is a little bit apart about it, from this, Stapel did not deny that his deceit was driven by ambition, but it was more complicated than that, he told me. He insisted that he loved social psychology, but had been frustrated by the messiness of experimental data, which rarely led to clear conclusions. His lifelong obsession with elegance and order, he said, led him to concoct sexy results that journals found attractive. It was a quest for aesthetics, for beauty, instead of the truth, he said. And maybe he is really more than others. He wanted to have this order and elegance. However, I think what you see often in publications or what journals want is a very neat story that starts with an idea, hypothesis, and then the results, and it should all follow neatly. And if you can tell such a story, then you can publish it in a high impact journal. So we see that the system wants this neat and orderly stories. However, if you have your data, and then as we talked already about, there might be some missing data or there might be some other things going on, so it's in general quite messy. So, and what are you doing now then with this messiness? And that is also something that we can do some good things with this, or some more great things with this, or also just throw those messiness out, or just create your own perfect world like Stapel did. So what are solutions to fraud? I think it's really difficult. Oh, yeah, a question?
Oh, yeah. To take a break, my apologies. But then you mentioned, for instance, in terms of missing data, you say it's okay to falsify or fit in data. Yeah, I thought I heard that.
Yeah, not just
this is for a good cause.
No, it's yes, for a real good cause. No, it's a good question. Is it good to make up data when you have missing data? Not if you just make them up and just or make them up in a way that they fit your research. But there are methods, imputation methods, that use the data of the other participants or other countries, or and then they average them and they use some methods, or even it's a whole research field about how you can impute your data when you have missingness. And in that case, and when you're transparent about how you do this, then it is okay. But not if you just make them up yourself. Yeah. Good to be clear about.
Actually, in generating other data, it is regular in time series. For instance, when you have previous years, you can either forecast or the missing, so it's possible.
Yeah.
You just need to give exactly the method, as you rightly said, the method used in forecasting.
Yeah, so in time series, it's more common, and then you should be also very specific about how you did this. Yeah. Yes?
So to give an example for that, would it be like the global warming estimates where you have previous data and then you just use models to predict the future? Like, you obviously don't have data for the future, but you use the data to have and you run informed research on what you estimate will be, and then of course your good cause is like to convince governments to act on it, but then you clearly need to show them your parameters in your modeling to convince them that your results are scientifically proven.
Yeah. Yeah, so this is another example when you want to predict climate change and these things. Then you also have to predict the future, but then you should be very transparent about the assumptions in your model and whether they're reliable and good estimates. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, but I think sometimes we need to be careful, because something may be scientific, but it may not be speaking to what is on the ground, the reality on the ground. Sometimes ago, when I was at the ELDB, a guy came from IMF to present a paper about some of the reforms that were done somewhere in East Africa. And he concluded that those reforms actually worked based on his estimated scientific whatever. But I was curious, so I quickly went to check some of the indicators of development in those countries within the period. And I raised a hot issue that day, that you claim that based on your study, that they worked, But given some of the evidence that we have here, it doesn't show that they have any improvement in this area. And it was like, okay, you didn't even look at those data and things like that. And I was wondering, though, how did you now come about here? So it's unclear to me. And when we talk about something being scientific, I think we should go a bit more beyond that. Because sometimes when you talk about, like somebody was talking about poverty, when you're talking about unemployment, in my country, for instance, the ILO put it at, I think, 6.7 or so. But we know that it's more than 50%. Yes. So how do we, yes, it may be scientific, but it doesn't speak to what is on ground. And I think we should be more concerned about that.
Yeah. Yes, that's true. I agree with you that there's sometimes the relation between the scientific picture and what's on the ground might be really different. And that can have different causes. It could be really scientific misconduct, but it could, of course, also be selecting strange measures. And I think in those cases, there might be more a scientific argument going on about which measures would be better and other studies to show that. But of course, I think also in this more gray area, the selection of those kind of measures or the combination of measures or those kind of things are probably more in this gray area. But I wouldn't directly consider them as scientific misconduct. Depends a little bit on the situation, of course. Yeah.
So I think that is having a problem with the, when you, for instance, when you want to conduct maybe a study, you design a study. I think you have a problem with a conceptual framework.
Yeah.
You need when you want to design something, you need to define according to. I think it's scientific. So you should much more check your conceptual framework.
Yes.
But though you say according to the reality what is on the ground, but it has been defined according to this one. This is considered as according to ILO, unemployment is considered. So I don't know when that's why transparency is important. So when you want to do policy suggestions, you take all those parameters into consideration. You said exactly how you did, so why for policy suggestions, you will take that into consideration. So your problem should be the concept, how to define the concept according to the context of your study.
I think I agree also with you, I think that's also maybe one of the gaps that might be somewhat missing also still the conceptual framework and how things relate. So that might be a nice add maybe. Just to continue, we have the detection. So of course there are whistleblowers, so people who recognize that something is going wrong, and they talk in the end about this at a higher level at the university, and then things the fraud case starts to be investigated, and that's I think how it in general goes. But it's also very difficult often for these whistleblowers, because you're often also in a dependent position to the person who conducts fraud. So it's kind of a complicated situation. It's interesting, for example, if you go to the website of the Office of Research Integrity, there you also have this game that you can play, the lab, in which you can play different roles and how this affects things. So that's, if you want to do something quite fun, then you could do that. Then we also have the statistical methods. So currently we see more statistical methods to detect fraud. So for example, we have Smeesters, also a Dutch guy from psychology, more management also. And his results, his fraud was detected by statistical methods For example, here we see a table from his paper, and you see here the means were very, very similar for the different conditions. However, they have quite some, these are the standard deviations, so there's a lot of variation. So with this much variation, finding these kind of similar means is too good to be true. However, when it's too good to be true, we still don't know whether it's scientific misconduct or that there are some real errors, sloppy science. So that's really hard to prove that it's really scientific misconduct. So in this case, it was clear that there were some subjects deleted, but still not know, they don't know how this happened exactly. And it's also, I was also in a committee that investigated some data of someone, and in the end we found that there were some things going on in the data, but it was definitely not proved that it was scientific misconduct. So we advised to retract the papers because there were definitely some errors in the data, so the conclusions in the papers didn't hold. However, it was not possible to really say that they committed fraud. And of course, I think things like this, thinking about this, talking about this, more transparency, more working together, more training, will also help to some extent to prevent fraud, although I don't think that we ever will be able to really just get all scientific misconduct away. So just get to the gray part. And this is about just a typical scientist. Yes?
I think maybe something which is burning. So before maybe we move on, I just wanted some clarification, because I can see you have given two methods on how you can detect through whistleblowers and also statistical methods.
Mm-hmm.
So I think when it comes to statistical methods, it's more or less about quantitative research, isn't it?
Yeah.
So whereby maybe you have falsified or fabricated some kind of data. So what happens to qualitative research, whereby somebody has maybe written some kind of has done some studies, and you know, in qualitative research is about maybe the case studies,
yeah,
the story of one individual,
yeah,
and then you use that maybe to change to make recommendation for change of policy, mm-hmm, or even a law. Like, for example, in legal research, you say even one case can change an entire,
mm-hmm,
maybe act or something. So how do you detect fraud in qualitative research?
So how do you detect fraud in qualitative research? Of course, not with the statistical methods, but I think still with the whistleblowers can happen. But I also know this guy who did more anthropological stuff, so, and he investigated some villages, but in the end those villages didn't exist at all. So then you sometimes you can, and then people start checking these things or checking the papers or the cases, then you can find irregularities and then go on this continue on this investigation. But it might be difficult if there's not enough information available to check.
So in qualitative research, you really have to go now to the field and investigate.
Probably.
Whether what has been written is true or not.
Yes.
But in quantitative, you just look at the numbers.
Yeah. Yeah. So in qualitative, you just have to go back to the field, and in quantitative, you can look at the numbers. Yes.
Yeah. If I have a good idea, in qualitative studies, at times you take, right? You have to interview when you are discussing.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can take it. It can be another way of of replication.
So I'll just continue and leave the
Perhaps in the interest of time, we can hold the questions till the end. There's been some great questions and discussion, but just to make sure we get all the content, and then we'll definitely have lunch right after, so we'll be plenty of time.
Enough time. Yes. So we have this typical scientist, and this scientist has a lot of pressure is going on, so he has to he needs to, or he or she needs to publish, but he or she is also a human, so several biases influences this scientist, and this scientist also has a lot of choices to make. So what happens when you are such a scientist is often that you are going to use opportunistically researchers' degrees of freedom. So what are those? And I will discuss those different, the pressure, the biases, and the choices. But first, yeah, we have some different wording for this. So we have the researchers' degrees of freedom. So I think this is more a broad term of you have to make a lot of choices. You just have to as a researcher. And you how you make those choices can have an influence on the outcome of your results. The questionable research practices is also more about how you use those research practices and then you also have the term more p-hacking, which I think is more like just doing everything to get this p-value below 0.05. And I think sometimes it's easier to say I don't do any p-hacking. However, it's harder to state that you never. You will always have some researchers' degrees of freedom, and you will always have to do something with those degrees of freedom. So, but just continue with the pressure. So this researcher, of course, wants to live somewhere, so he wants to have a house or rent a house. However, you need money, and in science, then this means that you want to have tenure. And to have tenure, you need publications, or even if you want to do graduate, you also need publications. So this is this pressure, and this means that this p-value should be below 0.05, because otherwise it's really hard to publish your research, and if you can't publish, then you don't have those publications, you don't have your tenure, and you don't can buy your house. Just to keep it a little bit simple, but in the end, this is the game that we are playing, right? So, as a researcher, you want to have these significant results. So these are the direct pressures, and there are a lot of consequences of having these, getting more money, more grant money, and all those things. However, we are really human as scientists. So we suffer from several biases, like confirmation bias. So everything that you confirmation bias means that that you see information and that is in line with your with your pre-existing beliefs. You accept that, and on the other hand, this confirmation bias. You also have that if things are not consistent with your pre-existing belief, then it's much harder to accept those things. Motivated reasoning is also that you're motivated to do that. You have the hindsight bias, like I knew it all along, so afterwards it sounds really logical that you did it in that exact way. Like you predicted it all along, and also the inclination to see patterns in any data. So also researchers, when you have a sample, what we will see later on, they think when you see something in your data, then you start really thinking that it's really there and trying to improve your data by maybe getting some outliers out to really show this pattern. Well, it still might be true noise. So, and this is this researcher who performs the data analysis and also is designing this study. He or she is always aware of this study's main hypothesis. He or she is also likely to believe this hypothesis, and he or she often benefits directly from finding support for it. So these are we have also some evidence, for example, from Fugelsang et al., who interviewed some molecular biologists about data that was consistent or inconsistent with their hypothesis. And those participants, they dismissed the inconsistent data on methodological grounds, so they were able to find some reasons to dismiss the inconsistent data, while the data that were consistent with their theory were just accepted and not met with much scrutiny. And Shimak also stated it as like empirical studies no longer test theoretical hypotheses because they can only produce two results. Either they support the theory when p is smaller than 0.05, or the manipulation did not work. So if you find the expected result and it's significant, then you're happy and just your theory is proven. However, if it's not significant, then you start looking into it, like what's going on, is there something going wrong, did the manipulation work well, or so you're really diving into it, and you're only doing that when you don't find this significant result at first hand.
Do you think a solution would be to disconnect the hypothesis and data collection to your data analysis? So maybe you could reform the way that research is done, and instead of having one researcher have two. So one of them works on the hypothesis and data collection, and then someone else steps in to do the analysis, so
yeah,
they don't have the bias of...
Yeah.
I mean, you can even not say the hypothesis and just say what do you see in this data,
mm-hmm,
instead of, and then see whether the two meet
yeah
up and discuss it.
So the question is whether it's good to separate the role of the writing down or coming up with the hypothesis and the data collection and the data analysis, and I think that's might be good to prevent some of those biases. However, it might be still that such a data analyst knows that you want to have a significant result, so that he's still working towards a significant result instead of just looking really objective to the data. And I think it's also really, so in that case, it might be good when you're doing more exploratory research, so you just let the data speak for itself. And on the other hand, more the confirmatory studies in which you use have this clear hypothesis beforehand, and then it would be good to also decide on the exact analysis beforehand. So have this analysis plan beforehand and register it. And then it doesn't matter who will be running the script to do the analysis.
But doesn't deciding the analysis beforehand bias it already, because you are trying to find that exact thing, so you're designing your analysis in order to show that?
Is it bad to decide your analysis beforehand? It depends on what you want. If you really have a clear hypothesis, like this experimental conditions should do better on this and this measure than this control group, then it's good to specify what kind of analysis you are doing in advance and not just afterwards when you've seen the data and maybe this method doesn't show a significant result, but the other one is showing a significant result. So then it's good to specify it beforehand and not let the outcome of your analysis influence the choice that you of what you finally do. Yes?
Yeah, that's called blind analysis. They do that in particle physics all the time.
Yeah.
And there are some psychologists that have started. There's a guy called Rob McGowan,
yes,
who wrote a paper on it. So there is some attempt to introduce that into psychology.
Yeah, so I think it's good to, in some cases, it's good to look more into the data, and sometimes it's not possible to really write an analysis plan beforehand because you have very complex data and you want to first check what whether some assumptions are violated or these kind of things. And then it might be good to look at the blinded analysis, and indeed some people are just looking into that right now. Yeah. So then we have the statistical bias, which was already mentioned by Tversky and Kahneman, which is also called belief in the law of small numbers. So when you just have a small sample, then you essentially think that this is similar to your whole population. even with this very small sample. So, and then we have to make all those choices, those researchers' degrees of freedom. And I like this example of outliers, because if you encounter an outlier in your data, then the question is, well, what to do? Remove or don't remove? And there might be some other options like correct it or winsorize or use a different statistical technique. Or so you can go on and go on, and you have all those different methods about what to do with an outlier. And there always is a consequence of your outlier handling method on your final result, so on your final p-value. So it's, yeah, you just even not doing anything, so keeping your outlier in your data has a consequence. So you have to make these choices, and what to do with an outlier is not something that is bad. I mean, we just have to do something with it, but or keep it as one of the options. But it shows that we have to make all those choices, and that is difficult, and it's also not clear what to do always. It's not always good to remove it. It's not always good to keep it in the data. It's not always this kind of method that will always solve your problem. So it's difficult what we should do. And of course, there are a lot of other researchers' DFs that we will be talking about, in which we also have all these kind of choices that we need to make. And then it can depend on how we use them, or how we whether we use them opportunistically or in other ways. So some people have already written down some of those choices that we need to make, and we as a group, we summarized them and wrote a paper about this. And we had this 5 stages, and we looked at different ways how these researchers' degrees of freedom can influence those phases. So we'll go over them. So this is the whole list that we came up with, but probably it's not everything that we can do. There might be a lot more, and also dependent on the different fields. So the first one is about hypothesizing. Already mentioned, hypothesizing after results are known, or harking, which means that you first are doing all your just looking into the data, like you just shoot on this wall, like this Texas shooter, and then you draw the bullseye around it. So you first look at your data, and if you find something interesting, then you write it down, whether like that would be the hypothesis that you already had beforehand. And also you can have quite fake hypothesis that fails to specify the direction of an effect, so that you can write it down in either way. The second phase, like the design phase, I think the important step that you can do to use all the research degrees of freedom is creating flexibility in your data. For example, with the dependent and the independent variables in your design. So you can create multiple manipulated independent variables and conditions, measuring additional variables that you can use as covariates or as mediators or moderators. The dependent variable can be measured in several ways. You could add additional constructs that you can also use as your primary outcome variable. So when you measure a lot, then you can also just shift a lot when you're doing your data analysis, and you can already create this flexibility in your design. And it's the question whether you should want all that flexibility. It might be if you are doing a truly exploratory study, but then you should also present it as such, and not present it as that you have predicted this specific outcome hypothesis all the time. Also about the exclusion of participants, who can already create some flexibility in your design. And of course, the power and the sample size. At least the studies in psychology are often underpowered, and the risk of bias is in general larger in underpowered studies and also the intuitions about power are often very flawed. So when people think that they have quite a good sample size, but in the end it's just underpowered. So even if the effect there is there, they have a very low probability of getting a significant result to show it. Then of course we have the data collection. It should be random, it should be correctly blinded. Sometimes you have to correct or code or discard some data during the data collection, the stopping rule. All those things can also influence the choices, or the, you have to make choices about that, how you implement them. And then we get to the data analysis, or data massage, or even data torture. And that's, of course, what to do with incomplete or missing data. We already talked about this beforehand, so you have different ways to handle that. Sometimes you need to pre-process your data. What to do when your statistical assumptions are violated. What to do with outliers. And of course, the flexibility that is in your design. So selecting this, which dependent variable will you select, or which independent variable do you use, covariates in your data. So you can use a lot of the flexibility often, and this gives you a lot of these researchers' degrees of freedom. And then of course also which statistical model, how do you estimate it, which software package do you use, or the computation of your standard errors. I mean, even different software packages might give some small different results. And also the inference criteria might also influence the outcome of your study. And then of course, how do you report it? Is it in such a way reported that you can reproduce it? So if you have the data, can you reproduce the results? Can you replicate it? Does it contain enough information to really replicate it, to rerun the study? So the misreporting of p-values, and presenting exploratory work as confirmatory. So how often are those questionable research practices, or this opportunistic use of this research of degrees of freedom, how often does this happen? So John et al. Did a questionnaire with more than 2,000 psychologists. Here I report some of the numbers. So they also use some truth conditions, but this is more the control condition. So these are just those people are just asked how do you sometimes, and then failing to report all of the studies dependent measures, and then we see that 63% fail to report all of the studies dependent measures. More than half sometimes decides whether to collect more data after looking to see whether the results were significant. 27% failed to report all of a study's condition. 15% stopped collecting data if the result is already significant. 22% rounded off a p-value, so the p-value is just above 0.05, but they report lower than 0.05. They selectively reported study that worked, also almost half of the participants. Deciding whether to exclude data after looking at the impact of doing so on the results, so 38%. You can use the outliers for that, of course. Reporting an unexpected finding as having been predicted from the start. The harking, 27%. Claiming that results are unaffected by demographic variables when one is unsure or knows that they do, 3%, and falsifying data by 0.6%. So you see, it's quite common, all those things, and we also have some other evidence from this. For example, this study by O'Boyle studied in management, and they looked at dissertations and the publications that came out of these dissertations, and then you see that in those publications there are more supported hypotheses and less unsupported hypotheses. So the ratio of supported hypotheses increases compared from dissertation to publication. And also failing to report all of a study's condition. So this is a study by Franco et al. And they had some specific, they looked at people that use a specific questionnaire, and to add additional questions was very difficult. So they knew that everything that was in there was really intended to be there, to be one of the conditions. So you see that in the questionnaire, you see that there are more conditions than in the article. If they would report all of the conditions, then it would be all in this line. However, we see that there are quite some studies that report less experimental conditions that were in the design. And also here we see that there are reported less outcome variables than in the article than there were in the questionnaire. Also this rounding off of a p-value, this is one of the things that I studied myself. Not directly because of this, but just looking at misreporting of statistical results. So if we have these papers, then often the statistical results are reported like this. So we have in this example an F-test with the degrees of freedom and the test statistic. And this is the p-value. And if you have this test statistics and the degrees of freedom, then you can recalculate this p-value. However, if you do this, then it, if you recalculate it, it's 0.06. So it's not significant anymore. And we looked at this kind of errors, and we found that in almost half of the papers, there is some misreporting error, although often these are just small rounding errors. But in 12% approximately, we see that this affects the statistical conclusion. And of course, then it is in general that a non-significant result is reported as significant and not the other way around. So this is a study done by me, but Michelle Nuiten, she developed also StatCheck, which is a program with R, in which you can check papers yourself. So you can check your own papers, for example. And it might be good to check your own manuscript before you submit it. And it's also used more and more in peer review already. So it's so and then some of the consequences of these opportunistic use of this research is degrees of freedom. So I think it's important so to realize that we have all those choices that we need to make, and it's really hard to make them in an unbiased way. It might not even be intentionally, or even that you're really focused on this p-value, but still more that you make those choices because this outlier, this you remove a certain outlier because you don't believe that it should be there because you really believe in your theory, or you can come up with some reasons in hindsight, a hindsight bias, to remove this person because he seemed to be a little bit sleepy during the experiment. So there's always kind of ways to come up with reasons to use those or make those choices, and those might have consequences. So one of the good illustration of what can happen is this paper by Daryl Bem, 2011, and it's about feeling the future, and it's really about what you think that it is. It's about predicting the future, and that we people can do this, because he had 9 experiments who showed this with more than 1,000 participants. In this experiments, they had, for example, decide behind which curtain they a certain picture would appear, and people did better than chance, so he could feel the future because those pictures were only placed behind these curtains after they made their decision already. So, but in this case, feeling the future, we know that we cannot feel the future in this way. So how could it still happen that he finds all these results, that he finds in 9 experiments a significant results that points to that we can feel the future? And of course, he can be very lucky to get this result every time. But when you dig more into his papers, then you will see that this feeling the future and with these curtains, it only worked when it were female participants and when it were erotic pictures and not with neutral or violent or something else. So you see already that he was able to shop in his data to get these significant results. However, it is published in one of the most important journals in social psychology. So when you do social psychology or personality psychology, then you want to publish in this journal. So it shows that that when this study can get in, what does it say about all those other studies that are in there? In this study, we know this should be false positive findings in these 9 studies, but what happens in those other studies in this journal? Probably we have a lot of false positive, so studies in which we find a significant effect, but in reality there is none, are much more common than what we expect. And Ioannidis already predicted that it would be around half of the studies, and we don't know for sure, but that could definitely be the case. So here a little bit about this exploratory research and confirmatory research. So confirmatory research is that you really predict it from the start. So you have a hypothesis and you and preferably all the choices that you make are made before you start with the when you start collecting your data. And if you have to do some more choices, you should be very transparent about what you're doing. And then on the other hand, we have the exploratory research, the harking, which is often, which is still published in a more, as if it is a confirmatory study, and this will also result in p-values that don't have any meaning. So these opportunistic use of researchers' degrees of freedom results in an increase of published false positive results, so studies that don't have a real effect but they show a significant p-value, also an overestimation of the effect size. And this is especially when you have also the small and underpowered studies. But this is, of course, one of the things that is, in the short term, good for a researcher to do just a small study and have a nice significant result with a large effect size. So for the incentives for the researcher in the short term are quite good to use those researchers' degrees of freedom. However, of course, in the end, we end up with distorted meta-analysis, irreproducible results, and a lowered credibility of science. And of course, that's not good for the researchers themselves as well. But we also need to think about the incentives of researchers in the short term. So solutions, I think it's important to start with realizing for yourself that you're human. So that you're, that you are inclined to use those researchers' degrees of freedom, although you're trying to be objective, and trying also to really prevent this opportunistic use of researchers' degrees of freedom. And therefore, it's really important to have this open science, to be transparent about all the choices that you make. Preferably pre-register your study if you can, and do all those things that we will be talking about during this training. And then I hope that in the end we will be able to move this this gray and get more and more white in science, in this open and transparent science. that's it. I think some questions, but maybe also a lot. What I suggest about statistical significance?
About journals.
Journals.
I seriously look for papers that have p-value that are significant.
Yeah, so the journals are looking for results that are significant. I think it would be good that journals look beyond just this p-value and just value research, good research, and it doesn't have to be significant. And I think it's, at least in psychology, you see some initiatives like publishing more of the pre-registered studies or publishing registered reports. So then you have to peer review before you really do the study. So you and then the results will be published no matter what your what the outcome will be. So I think those are ways that a journal can change this, but it will be, I think, a long way to really change that. Yeah, but that, at least there are more and more options to get your more transparent research or research with not statistically significant results published nowadays, I think. Yes. So we have the initiative here by Benjamin about changing this significant level from p is 0.05 to p is 0.005. So just making it harder to get a significant result. I think it's good to get a more to change it somewhat because 0.05 is not that much evidence right now. However, I think that by creating still this new boundary, then people will still use those methods to get below that new boundary. So you will still have the same problems and it won't be a whole solution. But it might be good to have a somewhat more stricter norm than we have right now, because that's not that strict right now. Yes?
Do you mean that even if you describe the method in which you used in removing out layers, is it considered as a scientific misconduct?
About removing outliers, when you describe it, that it's still considered scientific misconduct. No, I wouldn't certainly not describe it as scientific misconduct in, when you remove outliers. I think you should be transparent about what you do with outliers. That's really important, and it's also important to realize that, for example, if you have experimental design in which you compare groups, then removing outliers will already increase your type 1 error. However, when you do more correlational research, then keeping an outlier in your data might already increase your type 1 error. So it's quite a complex situation, but I wouldn't say that it's scientific misconduct, especially not when you're really transparent about this. Yeah. Other questions?
I think we'll break for lunch now, so we have about 45 minutes, and lunch will be out in the center area, so we can continue the discussion there.